NWAC has also noticed, you know, a lot more people, a lot more usage. And so we've spent the last 2 years trying to understand, well, what is the makeup of our backcountry community? And we've also really been trying to get the word out, like, hey, NWAC is a thing that you should make part of your process. So we started our Trailhead Outreach Program. And so my goal today is to do a really quick description of our program, for those not familiar with it, and then dive into the data just a little bit. It's like a tip of an iceberg, and maybe compel you to sign up for our Trailhead Outreach Program. That'd be great. All right. So Trailhead Outreach Program is really simple. We show up at trailheads that have easy access to avalanche terrain and set up a tent and a table with some coffee, cliff bars, some avalanche information, and some awesome volunteers. And they're out there connecting with our community, asking whether or not they're familiar with the avalanche terrain, and asking whether or not they want to take a survey. This has been a super effective program. The only reason that it could be effective is, as much as it is by the volunteers that we have. So our first year, we had 10 trailhead events at 4 different trailheads. Last year, because we had such an awesome response of our volunteers, we're up to 43 volunteers now, we more than doubled the number of events and ended up expanding our trailhead events more geographically, and we're at 12 different trailheads. You will notice that our survey count over the years actually went down last year. Some of this is because we started with a new platform and lost some of our data, but also we were at trailheads that weren't necessarily as popular, so we didn't quite capture the same quantity of information. And so our main goal was to try to understand, like, two things. Who's recreating and doing some outreach so that people know to check the forecast? In 2017, 2018, we went out, we made up a bunch of users. NWAC does identify with 5 user groups, so we have backcountry skiers, backcountry snowboarders, snowmobilers, snowshoers, and climbers. We dug a little bit further into it, just trying to outline the different types of users that we could see. But once we were in the thick of it, we noticed in 2017-18 that not necessarily everybody identified as one of these user groups. So in 2018-19, we came up with even more users. Okay, and there's a lot. Right? So the biggest group was snowshoers, actually, followed by backcountry skiers, and then people that were hiking. We found a lot of people that were just walking around identified themselves as hikers rather than snowshoers, and then we have backcountry snowboarders. And so from this information, we wanted to understand, well, how are people, what level of education did they have, as well as what type of equipment were they carrying with them in order to perform an avalanche rescue? And so this is what we found. 48% of people recreating at the trailheads that we were at, 48% had no avalanche education. And if we look at the level one and people that have higher than level two, only 33% of people recreating in our hills that, you know, took the survey had a level one or higher. And then if we look at the avalanche safety equipment use, 54% of people don't carry anything in the backcountry. 10% carry some items. I think I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to say 10 is pretty equivalent to none when it comes to, or sorry, some items is equivalent to none items when you're trying to perform a rescue. You need a beacon, shovel, and probe. So 36% of people recreating out in the Cascades are carrying the appropriate equipment to carry out an effective rescue. And so from this, we're trying to understand, well, who are recreating? And so digging down a little bit further, we broke it up into that crazy amount of user groups to figure out, well, what type of avalanche education do people have? And so in orange are the proportion of people that have no education. And if we dig in further and look at, let's say, 30% or more don't have any avalanche education, what we see is hikers, snowshoers, sledders, non-motorized, and people poking around make up that group. So these are people that are on foot rather than some kind of slidey device, right? That's my slidey device movement. And then snowmobilers as well. And what this tells the NWAC is, well, how can we better engage and educate this user group? So this has given us an opportunity to start creating very compelling and user-specific education opportunities as well as outreach programs. And if we look at the avalanche equipment, safety equipment, again, I'm bucketing some and none together, okay? We are seeing the same group carrying not the appropriate equipment when they're recreating out in our wintertime environment. We see the people that are walking around and snowmobilers. And then finally, the last thing that we were kind of trying to understand is who's checking the forecast, and if they're checking the forecast, are they also checking the what the danger rating is of the elevation bands? And I didn't actually capture that because that was a lot of information. But basically what we did is we graded the elevation band questions. We also took their information regarding their avalanche education, as well as what equipment they were carrying with them when they were traveling. And we created a safety index. And what we found was that people that were, oh, that was weird. There we go. The people that were familiar with the Avalanche Center statistically were more likely to carry the appropriate equipment, have the right, have more avalanche education training, and also were able to tell us what the danger rating was at the varying elevation bands. And so you are all in this room, right? I think so. Okay, that means statistically, right, you are more likely to have more education, carry the right safety equipment, and also probably more checking the forecast more regularly, which is why we kind of really want you to come and sign up for our Trailhead Outreach Program. If that's too much of a commitment for you, if you see us, it'd be awesome to stop by a tent and fill out a survey and chat with us so that we can better understand who is recreating. Because we recognize, like, this data is skewed. There's definitely biases in this data, for sure. And so we would love to collect more information. And finally, if you have any thoughts or questions about the program, you can email me, Sherry@nwac.us, or Molly@nwac.us. She's around here somewhere. But we would be more than happy to hear from you. And so that's my time. Do we have any questions? Awesome. No questions. Oh, there we go. Can we get a mic down here? This weird moderating my own questions.
This one over here.
Here.
Oh, hi.
Great presentation. I've seen you guys out there. I'm just wondering, when you are surveying people, I wonder about those people who are sleeping or just poking around. It seems like a really different user group than probably a lot of the people in this room. Do you feel like those people are, you know, you may not have data about this, but are they regularly saying, yeah, I'm going to go up into that cool-looking, mm-hmm. really steep basin up there, or are they like, I'm just going to walk 100 feet and see how it looks?
Do you that's know what I mean? A fantastic question, because we agree. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, some of this data, it's being misrepresented. And so something that I want to do next year is basically ask for people's GPS tracks to understand whether or not they're where they're actually going into terrain, to understand, like, are they accessing avalanche terrain and have no idea if they are? So that's a missing piece of information that we have. Yeah, and where I'm gonna, when I start doing some further analysis, I'm gonna be taking some of that into account. Yeah. Right here. Oh, sorry. Yeah, go next.
So I was a little surprised by the climbers had mm-hmm. all their gear and seemed to be knowledgeable. And I think that might be biased because you were probably just interviewing people in the wintertime, yeah. and there's not a lot of climbing, because I think climbers in the summertime mm-hmm. are not very knowledgeable.
Right, so that's a, no, that's actually a great point. Because the people that we generally got that were climbers, they were ice climbers and more aware of the terrain that they were accessing. Yeah, you were correct. And then I think we have time for one more over here.
For this outreach program, are you guys planning on working with any of the social scientists or professional?
As I've been listening to these presentations today, I'm like, I'm definitely going to be partnering with some of these people. Yeah. But if you also have any ideas, I'd love to hear them. So, all right. So thank you, Cheri Higman.